Good morning on this beautiful, sunny, spring-like Sunday morning. On behalf of the First Presbyterian Church of Fairfield, I'd like to welcome everyone who is here in the sanctuary, as well as all of you who are participating online. Whether you're a member, a regular visitor, or here for the very first time seeing what this church is all about, we warmly welcome each and every one of you. Let us now enter into a time of worship. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, praise his name. Proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. Let us join together to worship him. Please stand if you are able. Hymn number 262 can be found in the blue hymnal. Be seated. Remember that our Lord Jesus can sympathize with us in our weakness, since in every respect he was tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with boldness approach the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Please join us as we say the prayer of confession, saying together, Heavenly and most loving Father, you have graciously mapped out a path of righteousness for us. Yet, at times, we willfully choose to chart our own course, one of sinfulness, greed, arrogance, and even impiousness. At other times, we unwittingly stray from your path without regard for our misguided choices. We sometimes fall prey to temptation, preferring to enjoy self-indulgence rather than glorifying you and living a life of virtue. Lord, forgive our sins and redeem us through your mercy. Help us to submit to your will and faithfully follow your plan. Through Jesus Christ, we pray. Please take a moment now to silently confess your sins to God. Because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Amen. If you are able, please stand for the Gloria Patri. Please be seated. Thank you.
Well, good morning. Today we continue our sermon series, In the Beginning. It is based on the book of Genesis. The book of Genesis literally means book of beginnings. And today we're going to see the beginning of languages and nations. That languages and nations did not always exist the way they do today, and so there was a beginning. And our scripture passage is Genesis chapter 11, verses 1 through 9. It is the well-known story of the Tower of Babel. Listen now for the reading of God's word. Now the whole world had one language and a common speech. As people moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. They said to each other, "Come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly." They used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens so that we may make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we will be scattered over the face of the whole earth." But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. The Lord said, "As if one people speaking the same language, they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language, so they will not understand each other." So the Lord scattered them over the face of the earth, and they stopped building the city. That is why it was called Babel, because the Lord confused the language of the whole world. From there, the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole earth. This is the word of the Lord. The book of Genesis is the book of beginnings. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, God created light and darkness, sun and moon. In the beginning, God created plant life and animal life. And in the beginning, God created human beings, Adam and Eve. And in the beginning, God told Adam and Eve, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth." And as we saw last week, the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat it, you will certainly die." And what do Adam and Eve do? They eat from the forbidden tree. And in Genesis 3, in the beginning, we see how humanity, created in the image of God, created to reflect the goodness of God, is touched, twisted, warped, and bent by sin toward sin. And the story of humanity's beginning is a story of things going from good to bad and bad to worse. Adam and Eve are blessed with two children, Cain and Abel. And the first family is like our prototypical American family. It is a family of four. And there are four until Cain kills Abel. Cain kills his brother. And I know that I often read this story in our children's Bible to my kids. It's my son Ben's favorite story. I don't know what that tells you about Ben. Pray for our family. And I think that when these stories become so familiar, we become numb to the gravity, the enormity of the story. Our first parents are the first parents to experience the loss of a child. The first parents are the first parents to experience the incomprehensible loss of a child at the hands of their other child. It is the beginning of murder and grief and loss. In Genesis 4, a man named Lamech takes a second wife. It is a violation of his marriage vow. It is polygamy. It is the beginning of the oppression of women. Lamech then pens a poem boasting about a revenge killing. He writes this down. He was harmed by a young man, and he notes, he boasts that he killed him. It is the beginning of vengeance. In the beginning, humanity is bent by sin and toward sin. St. Augustine famously wrote, before Christ, humanity is unable to not sin. Protestant reformer Martin Luther taught, before Christ, you can't do anything but sin. The beginning of sinful humanity is the beginning of violence, the beginning of oppression, the beginning of grief and loss. The consequences of sin are broken hearts, broken families, broken communities, broken societies, and a broken world, a world broken by sin. In the beginning, things go from good to bad and bad to worse. And in the beginning, in the book of Genesis, Lamech is an individual picture of a universal problem. He's the embodiment of humanity's condition and state, our sinful condition. Genesis 6:5, the Lord saw how great the enormity of the wickedness of the human race, not just Adam and Eve and their family or their immediate descendants. No, no, no. The wickedness, the greatness of the wickedness of the inhuman, of the human race, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. What is the Lord showing us about humanity and about the world? It's bad out there because it's bad in here. Got it? It's sinful out there. Things are going from bad to worse out there because things are bad, things are sinful, things are wicked, things are evil in here and in here. Until we let God deal with what's happening through his son, Jesus the Christ, things will continue to go from good to bad and bad to worse out there. And in Genesis 6, we know God's famous response. God cleanses the earth. God wipes the slate clean. God sends the flood upon the earth. And God starts fresh with Noah and his family of five. And in Genesis 9, the first story after the flood is that of Noah in a garden. Don't miss this. When you read it and when God's people heard it for the first time, perhaps they had their fingers crossed. They were hopeful because where did Adam and Eve start? They started in a garden. They walked in fellowship with God in the garden before the fall. And God is starting fresh with Noah. And so there's hope that perhaps Noah and his family, like Adam and Eve, are walking with God in perfect fellowship in a garden. And Noah plants a vineyard, and many of you are thinking, sounds like a great start to a new life. Noah gets drunk. Something happens with his son in a bedroom. It's not, we don't get the details, right? There's certain things that you don't want to talk about in your family that are better left unsaid. Well, that's what happens in the book of Genesis. We don't get the details, but we know it's bad. And just like the story of Adam and Eve, Genesis chapter 9 ends with a curse. And in Genesis 10, from Noah's line of descendants, we are introduced to diverse clans in diverse lands. We're introduced to the beginning of nations and languages. And you begin to see people with different skin colors, different cultures, different histories, and different ethnicities. It is the beginning of nations and languages. And Genesis 11, the story of Babel, takes us back to how that happened. How did this happen in Genesis 10 that now we have the nations and the languages? And as we read, verse 1, now the whole world had one common language and a common speech. Genesis 11 is what biblical scholars call prehistory or primordial history. And they call it prehistory because it's really difficult to date. We don't really know when it happened, but what we do know is that humanity is still in its infancy years. And linguists and anthropologists are becoming more and more aligned with the Bible in verse 1. And I love when that happens, when science catches up to Scripture. Now, many scientists are claiming that in the beginning, in humanity's infancy, we did have one common language and one common speech. Verse 2, as people moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. Adam and Eve moved eastward. When Cain was sent out to wander the earth by God, Cain moved eastward. And so, like their forefathers, people moved eastward. And they actually found a really good place to settle. Shinar is a great place to settle. It's flat. We know it's a plain. It's also tucked between the Tigris and the Euphrates River. What do you need to live? Water. It's a fertile Crescent Valley, a great place to grow food. And so if you want to begin settling and building a city, this is an ideal place to do it. So they move eastward and they settle there. And in verse 3, they said to each other, "Come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly." They use brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. And here we have an ancient technological advancement. It's not quite AI, artificial intelligence, but you got to start somewhere. And they were able to make bricks and tar for mortar. And so now they could build large buildings, buildings with millions and millions of bricks. And then they said, verse 4, "Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens so that we may make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we will be scattered over the face of the whole earth." John Calvin, one of the theological fathers of the Presbyterian Church, categorized their building project as an atrocity of evil. John Piper, a Reformed Baptist preacher, called their attempt to build a spectacular sin. I don't know about you, but I watch the evening news from time to time. This does not strike me as an atrocity of evil or any sort of spectacular sin. Does it to you? Yet why does God oppose and nullify their plan to build and settle? It doesn't feel like something so bad. Don't we all want a place where we can settle down and call home, where we can find food and water and security? Perhaps God's reason for opposing and nullifying their plan is not based on their actions so much as it is their attitude. Perhaps it's not just about what they're doing out there, but what's happening in here. 2 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7. "The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." What does God see when he looks at the heart of the city? What does God see when he looks at the heart of the people of Babel? And the scripture identifies two forces or powers at work in their hearts. Yes, there are two forces. You may want to call them spiritual forces, sinful forces at work in the heart of the city. Pride and fear. Arrogance in defiance to God's word. Ego and anxiety. The building is motivated by two things: a desire to make a name for themselves, there's your pride, and a resistance against being scattered over the face of the whole earth. Now keep in mind, in the beginning God said, what was the first thing that God said to Adam and Eve? Be fruitful and fill the earth. You must be scattered. Genesis 9, God said again, be fruitful and fill the earth. You must be scattered. They actively attempt to control their lives in defiance to God's word. There's a lack of trust in the word of God. Pride says, you know, I know what God says. I think I really know better than God. Ego says, I don't need God. And arrogance says, I cannot be stopped. We see this pride and this ego and this arrogance as a motivating factor in their building and settling. Second, they build to make a name for themselves. You can see it in the scripture. The reason for the building is actually to make a name for themselves, because people would build towers in ancient days, especially on plains, for security. You could go up the tower and look out on the horizon and see if there were potential threats on the horizon. But that's not their reason. Their reason is to make a name for themselves. They are a people whose number one goal is their name and their fame, not God's. Their greatest desire is for people to praise them. When they see what we have done with this tower, they'll see how big we are. We'll be big. We'll make it big. We'll be significant. We'll be important. We'll get the glory. We'll make a name for ourselves. Isn't that what social media is all about? Making a name for yourself? Admire me, like me, make me big. We will make a name for ourselves. Isn't that what vain ambition and greed is all about? Look at me, look at what I have built, look at what I have. We will make a name for ourselves. And here's the tragedy behind self-absorption, narcissism, and living for the praise of people. And by the way, God opposes it, not simply because God is some sort of egomaniac. God opposes it because it's bad for who? Come on, wake up. What is this me first, look at me doing to an entire generation of young Americans? It is creating depression and anxiety. God forbids it because it's bad for who? It's bad for you. It's bad for who? It's bad for us. It's bad for who? It's bad for creation. We're assigning importance to that which is unimportant. We're living for that which does not satisfy. We are relying on those things that will not last. And it's unhinging us as a society. God will never lead you toward the very things that will leave you empty. God stands in opposition. It's not bad because it's forbidden. It's forbidden because it's bad for you. And in attempting to take God's place in the limelight becomes our God. It will be all you have. And when the limelight fades, and it will, there will be nothing left of you. As Jesus says, you can gain the whole world and lose your soul. Isn't God good warning us against such temptations, such worthless pursuits? Last Saturday, we went to my father-in-law's for his 74th birthday party. Had a great time celebrating my father-in-law. As you know, as you get older, you don't take anything for granted. So we don't take those moments for granted. And we celebrated my father-in-law. And then we all went into the family room. And there were a lot of little cousins running around that house having a great old time. And all the adults sat in the family room in a big circle. And the little cousins came in and they started to perform for us. And we're talking about kids between the ages of 1 and 10. And so they're depending on their skill level, they're jumping in the middle, they're doing cartwheels. And then all the parents, all the family claps for them, right? Others are jumping in and they're doing somersaults. If you're Benny, you just stop at the top right on your head. It's not even a somersault, but we clap for little Benny, hallelujah. They're doing karate chops and dance moves and we're having this great, great time. And one of the cousins, she was shy. Little five-year-old girl, if you see my little daughter Violet running around, she looks like Violet. And she was afraid to go in the middle. She was afraid to go out and show us what she had. And so we were encouraging her. And she was strapped with so much fear that she almost began crying. And as we were kind of winding down after we saw about, 6,000 somersaults and cartwheels and our hands hurt from clapping so much, this little girl gets up, she stands in the middle, and she starts doing her karate chops and her karate punches, and she just forgets about her fear, and she just starts bah, 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 and the family erupts in praise and clapping for this little girl. And it almost makes me emotional thinking about it, because when she sat down back on that couch, this is what it's all about, right? When she sat down back on that couch on her mother's lap and all her cousins gathered around her and said, "You did such a great job," I saw this little girl who was so covered in fear experiencing this joy, this bliss. She felt so wonderful. It was that moment of, I can do it too. I'm brave. I'm courageous. I showed them what I had. I did what God made me to do. And so when we talk about ego and we talk about pride and we talk about not living for people's praise, we're not talking about forsaking that very thing that God has placed you on earth to do. We're not talking about walking away from those things that when you do it, they make you feel fully alive. We're not talking about not being your full self in Jesus Christ. No. What we're talking about is this. Making the tower the thing you live for. Let's talk about it. deriving your self-esteem from the things that you can build. So let me give you an example of that. As a pastor, I would want to derive my self-worth or my self-esteem or how I feel about myself based on how the church is doing. As someone who's out in the marketplace or in the workforce, your tower would be building this career that is lucrative, this career in which you have power and control, where people look up to you, and making that your very reason for living. Basing your self-esteem and your self-image on the towers that you can build. If you're a parent, it means that your tower could become the success of your children. It becomes your tower, and you start deriving your self-esteem and your self-worth. Your life revolves around this thing that you believe will make you feel good about you. Cover your shame, right? This is just the story of Adam and Eve repeating again. They, as we saw last week, they cover themselves in fig leaves. You know that. It's to cover their shame and their guilt. Say, we're not good enough as we are. We must do something to prove ourselves so that we can feel good about ourselves. And in the case of Babel, it's just the manifestation is the building of a tower. They'll talk about me. They'll remember me. They'll take a selfie with me. I'll make a name for myself in this city, in this neighborhood, in this company, in this church, whatever your context must be. And here's my advice to you. You ready for this? This is for everybody. Whether you believe this story happened or not, here it is. Live for what satisfies. Live for what matters. Live for what lasts. Take risks, be brave, use your gifts, and give God all the glory. Live not for your name or for your sake, but live for the name and for the sake of Jesus Christ. It's that simple. It actually gets worse in terms of their ego and their arrogance when we return to the Tower of Babel. The Tower of Babel is not like towers as we envision them. It was actually called a ziggurat. You want to say that with me? Ziggurat. It was called a ziggurat. Ziggurats were wide structures with steps built into it. The reason they built these step towers was to connect earth to heaven. The ziggurats in this region were actually called gateways to heaven. They were building a gateway to heaven. The idea was if you built it up to heaven, right, this tower that reaches to the heavens, that was their intention, people could ascend up to the heavens, the gods could come down to earth, and the people who build this ziggurat operate under the assumption that they can make their own way up to heaven by their own accomplishments. So it is not just arrogance, it is spiritual arrogance. And here is God's response. It's supposed to be funny. We all know that God sees everything. Verse 5. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. So this here's the statement, right? God sees everything. This thing that you thought was so great, that you believe was like the greatest accomplishment, that would impress and stand out to God, and even make God want to come down to earth, give you full access to God, that tower that you built, the greatest tower in the world, it's so puny God can't even see it from heaven. That's why he had to come down. Like, why would he have to come down to see it? Well, it's a statement. I couldn't see that little mud tower you built. I couldn't see it from heaven. Also, FYI, I don't need your tower to come down to earth. If you read the scriptures, it doesn't say that the Lord descended upon the tower that they built. No, no, no. He just came down all by himself. He didn't need that little puny tower that was going to fall apart. The lesson is, whatever you think that you can do to make it to heaven by your own effort, just know that it'll get you nowhere close. You took a couple steps up the ladder. You thought it was going to bring you closer to the sun. You're still 94 million miles away. The Lord is showing us the way you'll meet with me is not by your efforts, accomplishments, or hard work. It's when the Lord comes down to you. And so the Lord comes down. What they're doing is all about them. It's not about God. It's not about the benefit of the city. And God says, come. And they say, come, let us build. Come, let us make bricks. And so this is another little mocking play on them. The Lord says in verse 7, come, let us, he uses their language, come, let us go down and confuse your language so that they will not understand each other. And the Lord is so merciful. The Lord is so good. The Lord is so kind. The Lord doesn't send a flood. He doesn't send fire. With the touch of a tongue, the Lord confuses their language. And this is where we get the Hebrew word Babel, which means confusion. And thereafter, in the city of Babel, when you went to the bakery, they were speaking Chinese. When you went to the butcher, they were speaking Russian. When you went to the hairdresser or the barber, they were speaking Arabic. And Babel became a really inconvenient, uncomfortable, confusing place to live. When I order bread, I get muffins. When I ask for cucumbers, I get carrots. When I ask for a steak, I get chicken. And when I go for a little trim, they shave it all off. People scattered. The irony of the story is they build a tower to make a name for themselves. Well, they're famous, but they're infamous. And they build a tower in a city so that they will not scatter. And what does the Lord do? The Lord scatters them to their own lands with their own languages in their own nations. You ready for me to wrap it up? At the first service, they did not. We're Presbyterian. I know we're not going to clap, but you can nod at me. Little nod. You ready for me to wrap it up? At the first service, they didn't give me a nod. And we ran a little bit over. Amen? We ready for the end? You're already confused. It all sounds like Babel. Okay. Let's bring it back to the gospel. The story of humanity is the story of good to bad and bad to worse. And we saw it play out thousands of years ago. We see it play out today. And as we've said, it's tough out there, it's rough out there, because there's something off in here and in here. And after thousands of years of waiting, after this story of the God who came down to confuse their language and to scatter them, the story of humanity once again becomes the story of God becoming human and coming down. The God who comes down from heaven is man, who is God, the Son, Jesus Christ. And it is only the one from heaven who can bring heaven to earth. It is only the one who comes from heaven who can welcome humanity into heaven. And while humanity is proud, Jesus is humble. And while humanity seeks to be better than others, Jesus considers others better than himself. And while humanity attempts to make their names great, Jesus made himself nothing, becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. And on the third day, Jesus rose from the dead. And therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name above every name. And after Jesus rose from the dead, Jesus said to his followers in Acts 1, it was about 120 people, similar to our size community, "You will receive power and you will be my witnesses." You're not to stay in Jerusalem. You're not to simply settle here and make a name for me here. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And Jesus Christ calls his people to a new beginning and calls his people to scatter and announce to the world that there is a new beginning. That yes, the world is broken and it does not have to stay broken. Yes, individuals and families and communities are broken, but Jesus Christ came to seek and save the lost. He came as healer of the world. And he says this, ultimately, in Acts 2, God touches their tongue. Languages were confused, but in Acts 2, God touches the tongues of his people, and he gives them the capacity to praise God, to speak God's word in all languages. It is a new beginning. And a world broken by sin will receive the God who has come down to seek and save the lost. We're gathered here today. Here's your action step. We're gathered here today. But we will not stay gathered. We're gathered here today to be scattered. And on this day, God scatters us into different homes, different neighborhoods, different communities, different schools, and different workplaces. Why? We're scattered to preach his name. We're scattered to share the name above all names. We're not scattered to make our names great, but to make much of his names. And when we make it all about ourselves, things go from good to bad and bad to worse. But when we make it about Christ's name and fame, Jesus Christ offers broken individuals, broken families, broken communities in a broken world a break from the confusion, a break from the fear, a break from the sin, and a new beginning with God. And so over the coming weeks, what we want to challenge you to do is what God has called us all to do, and that is to invite people into this community to see what God is doing and saying and how God is healing over Easter. Easter is a great time to invite people to church. And so this week I want to invite you. We have invitations and calendars to take one for yourself and to place it on your refrigerator. But also, on your way out, to take someone who needs to hear the message, the name above all names, the name of Jesus Christ. See, it's not about our towers and our names. It's always about lifting up his name. May it be so on this day and through our community this Easter. In Jesus' name, amen.
In caring for the outcast and the lost, that in joyful, selfless sharing we may never count the cost. Find us and form us, oh God.
Please stand, if able, as we say our affirmation of faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. As God's people, we are called to love one another by praying for the needs of the human family and our church family. And we'll do that today by saying together, we pray to the Lord. Let us pray together. That our communities, nation, and the world would be freed from vengeance, violence, and oppression. Together we say, we pray to the Lord. That those who govern around the world would overcome their pride, vain ambition, greed, and fear to benefit those they've been called to lead. Together we say, we pray to the Lord. That our nation would honor those of different nationalities, cultures, races, languages, and religions as people made in God's image. Together we say, we pray to the Lord. that our church would seek not to make a name for ourselves, but only to exalt the Lord's name. Together we say, we pray to the Lord. Sustain those who need your healing touch. Make the sick whole. Bruce Tomasco, Don Brown, Bill Fair, Richard Bellows, Linda Brikes, Nancy Stackhouse, and Hannah Morrison. Comfort those who mourn, the Blows family, the Bales family, the Schimpf family. Uphold all who suffer in body or mind, not only those we know and love, but also those only known to you. Together we say, we pray to the Lord. Let us now say the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to say by praying together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This Tuesday night at 7 p.m. in our chapel, we continue our journey through Lent with a prayer service. There will be childcare provided at that service, and the theme of the prayer service is encountering Christ on the cross. It will be a time of reflection and contemplative prayer. That is Tuesday at 7 p.m. During Holy Week on Thursday, March 28th, we have our Maundy Thursday service, and it will begin at 5:30 p.m. with soup and bread. And from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m., we have communion and our symbolic foot washing in Brooks Hall. And it is a powerful service. There is childcare. And we ask you to RSVP on your next step card if you will be attending. We want to make sure that we have plenty of soup and bread. And also, on your next step card, which is in your pew, you can also sign up to serve. And you may serve by providing soup or bread on that evening, or by setting up or breaking down. But we invite you to grab that next step card. It won't bite you. You can pick it up. You can fill it out, RSVP, and serve if able for our Maundy Thursday service. Also, we take up an offering every Sunday, and it all goes to the work of the Lord. And we know you're busy, and so we want to make giving to God's work easy. And so if you'd like to sign up for electronic giving or need help going online and getting plugged into electronic giving, we would just ask that you fill out your next step card, and we will get you connected with that opportunity. For those who bring cash or check, there are offering plates in the back, and you are welcome to place your next step cards along with your offering and plates in the back at the conclusion of your service. And also, don't forget, grab an invitation for Easter. And we have there's calendars on those, and take one of those home with you to put on the refrigerator. And also take one for perhaps someone in your life who needs to hear the message of hope this Easter. Let us now continue our worship of God by standing, if able, for our doxology and our closing hymn. as we go from this place scattering, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be upon each one of us this day and forevermore. And all God's people say together, Amen.